This is Will McCauley with CNTelect. I'm going to review this week's proprietary natural gas research analysis. This week we looked at natural gas production and its impacts on physical gas flows in the United States. I've had a number of clients who are familiar with sort of the macro picture of oil and gas production growth in the United States, but are maybe a little bit less familiar with what those trends mean on a micro or between region levels of physical natural gas flows. So we're going to do a little postmortem on what has happened over the last 5 years. Just to set the stage, the U.S. produces about 86 BCF a day of total natural gas. We're going to look at what EIA defines as its seven primary producing oil and gas regions. These regions cover or produce about 74 to 75 BCF a day of that total production. The main two regions we're not going to discuss today are Alaska and the Gulf of Mexico, as they have different physical movement drivers than I think the rest of the lower 48 states. Just again, from 2014 through 2018, the regions that we're going to discuss produced 43 BCF a day in 2014, but in 2018, that number is 75 BCF. So they've seen 32 BCF a day of growth in these regions. The majority of the growth has come from two main areas, the Marcellus Utica in the Northeast, and then the Permian Haynesville in what the EIA defines as the South Central region. First thing I want to look at is a map of what those basins are, or regions are, excuse me. Again, these are EIA definitions of these regions. So when you see Appalachia, that is a combination of both the Marcellus and the Utica plays. The others I think everyone is familiar with. Again, for this analysis, we're going to focus on the Haynesville, which straddles the eastern Texas and west Louisiana borders, and then the Permian Basin, which is, again, primarily in Texas, but also flows into southeastern New Mexico. While the Permian is primarily considered an oil basin, there is a significant amount of natural gas that is produced by that area. This chart on the left here shows what total production in those basins has done over time. Again, this represents the growth from about 43 BCF a day to the 75 BCF a day that I discussed previously. The main drivers, again, Marcellus Utica has gone from producing 14.5 BCF a day in 2014 to 30.4 BCF a day in 2018. That's growth of 15.9 BCF per day, or 110%. That is represented by the black base that you see on the chart on the left. The second is the Permian, which is the second highest grower in volumetric terms. It's grown from 5.2 BCF to 12.4 BCF a day, or 7.2 BCF over that five-year period. It's 138%. And then the final area is the Haynesville, which has gone from 6.6 BCF a day to 9.6. A smaller growth in percentage terms and in BCF terms, but still 3 BCF a day of production is nothing to ignore for this analysis. The more important factor to think about in these regions is that Marcellus Utica is in the Northeast, which has traditionally been a consuming region of the United States, along with the Midwest, whereas the Permian and the Haynesville are in the traditional production areas of the United States. So the fact that the Marcellus Utica gas has grown significantly has had a big impact on total flows and direction of physical natural gas flows within the EIA regions. What you have here is a simplistic chart or representation of the main EIA regions that they review. You have the five main regions. South Central comprises mainly Texas, Oklahoma, and Louisiana production areas. The East includes all of the Southeast and the Atlantic coast, including the Northeast and the majority of the Marcellus and Utica production. The Midwest is everything in between. It has a little bit of the Western Marcellus and Utica production, but it is mainly a consumption area rather than a production area. Mountain area includes both the Rockies, the Niobrara, and some of the southwestern areas, and then the Pacific is primarily California, but also to a lesser extent the Pacific Northwest. So again, traditionally natural gas has flowed from South Central regions into all of the others for consumption. That is still happening, but the way that it's happening is probably a little bit different than it has in the past. I think this next chart is the one that's really interesting, it really tells the story. The big cross that you see in the middle is the significant change that we've seen over the last 5 years in gas flows, both from the Northeast, East production basins into the Midwest, and then the decline of the production from the, or the flows from the South Central region into the Midwest. So the upward sloping blue line represents natural gas flowing from the Northeast, Marcellus and Utica basins into the Midwest. So that gas has gone from 0.6 BCF a day in 2014 to 9.2 BCF a day in 2018. That's 8.6 BCF a day increase, or 1,400+% growth over a 5-year period. Obviously, that gas that is flowing into the Midwest has supplemented or replaced gas coming both from Canada and the Mountain Region, but more importantly, from what the EIA defines as the South Central region, which is the declining gray line that is declining from 2014 through 2018. So in 2014, that region sent 7.8 BCF a day to the Midwest through the MidCon and through some of the mountain pipes as well. Now in 2018, that number is zero, net zero. There are positives and negatives for any given month, but averaging across the entire year of 2018, there have been 0 BCF a day of gas flowing from traditional producing regions into the traditional consumption area of the Midwest. Now, some of that gas has flowed from South Central into the East, but it has primarily gone to the consuming areas of the Northeast, but it has not been enough to fully replace the Midwestern demand. So you see that gas went from about 6.9 BCF a day in 2014 to 8.2 BCF a day in 2018, 1.2 BCF a day, only 18%. So there's a significant chunk of gas that used to flow into the Midwest that has had to find alternate outlets. What have those outlets been? Two of the big drivers have been natural gas power generation, which is consuming a good portion of gas both in the Texas ERCOT region, but also in PJM. The second big outlet has been just general industrial demand and petrochemical demand along the Gulf Coast and some greenfield and brownfield assets that are being built. The third outlet has been exports to Mexico via pipeline. And then the final outlet has been LNG exports from the Gulf Coast area. There are a number of LNG projects coming online in the next year, 2 years, that will increase that outlet. But that has been a small but growing outlet. So I think at CNTelect, we feel that the production story is far from over. It's going to continue unabated, especially in the lower cost basins, Permian and Marcellus, Utica. And really the question is, the gas is going to be there. What mix of outlets is going to handle a smooth and efficient transition from the previous setup 5 years ago, where we are today, and the next 5 or 10 years? We still think it's going to be a mix of the four things that I discussed previously: natural gas, power generation, industrial and petrochemical demand. A number of projects have already been announced in the Marcellus, Utica area to take advantage of that low-cost feedstock. Exports to Mexico will continue to ramp, and then LNG exports, I think, are going to be a significant growth driver over the medium term and long term. So we know that what the mix is going to be in terms of the players. We don't know what the volumes of each of those is going to be, but we know something's going to have to change and be different. There are going to be winners and losers. We can't predict today what those winners and losers will be in 5 years. We have some ideas, but we can't say for certain what that is going to be. There will be winners and losers, as there are in any change. So for more details on this full research analysis piece, our view on the potential winners and losers in this transition, please visit us at cntelect.com.